All right, well, welcome back. Alongside Chris Johnson, I am still Christopher Harrison. And what do you say we pick up, to a certain extent, sort of where we left off? I mean, earlier we've taken a look at the basic concept of SharePoint development, and we kept talking about this whole app thing. And then we went off and we did something slightly different, where we talked about our list structure and the basics of working with all that. Well, now what we want to do is really take the first step towards building apps. Now, the biggest thing that you might remember about our conversation about apps is the fact that no code is going to be able to run on the server. So we are going to need client-side code. And that's exactly what we want to take a look at here in Module 3, client-side SharePoint development. Now, what we're going to start off with is the client-side object model, in particular, the client-side object model for JavaScript. And again, I'll probably just keep calling it CSOM over and over and over and over again.
Sure.
But in any event, what we're going to see here is that this is very similar to the server-side object model. That if you've done the server-side object model, this is a relatively natural way for a SharePoint developer to make the migration into doing apps and into doing client-side code. But this really isn't a natural way for a normal JavaScript developer to start doing client-side code. That what's much more natural for a JavaScript developer is to utilize REST, or representational stateful transfer. I love that acronym, because you know that just clears things right up, right?
Oh, it's
yeah.
Obvious.
Yeah,
obvious.
Exactly. So in any event, REST, as we're going to see, is all about formatting API or formatting URLs to go get our data and getting our data back typically in JSON and JavaScript object notation rather than utilizing the CSOM objects that we're going to have instead. So let's start off by taking a look at the CSOM and how all that works. Now, the biggest thing to understand about the CSOM, about the client-side object model, is it is sort of based on the object model that we have for the SharePoint server side. So again, if you've been doing that server-side object development, making the move into the client side is relatively straightforward. What you're also going to notice is that the client-side object model is built with the concept of making calls from the client. So whenever you're making calls from the client, whenever you're calling a web service, and at the end of the day, that's all that we're going to be doing here, so we're just going to be calling a web service. When we're calling into a web service, we want our calls, and this is in fact the technical phrase, and I love this. The technical phrase is we want our calls to be chunky, not chatty.
Correct. Yes. We want to use this concept of batching, correct?
Yes.
Where we put a whole lot of calls together, and then we make a call over HTTP and we get the response back. And if we do that too many times, then we're introducing the cost of all of the latency of all those calls. So we want to squish them all together and make them as efficient as possible, both in the least number of calls possible, bringing back the least amount of data possible,
yep,
and in the least chatty protocol.
Exactly, exactly. Now, what you're going to notice on the little slide here, on the little demo, is over on the left-hand side is our app, over on the right-hand side is SharePoint. And over on the left-hand side, we are going to have our own custom JavaScript. And our JavaScript could be doing really whatever it is that that we might want. And on top of that, we can use whatever library it is that that we desire. So if you're wanting to use jQuery, if you're wanting to use jQuery UI, if you're wanting to use Knockout, whatever it is that that you're wanting to do JavaScript-wise, you can go off and do it. So you're not limited to your actual normal JavaScript code.
Yeah, I think this is really important as a really important enhancement of the new SharePoint app model is this concept of sort of untangling ourselves from the innards of SharePoint and being able to use these frameworks and libraries and so forth that, you know, all the cool kids out there in JavaScript land are using today that we've had to suffer without for so long. And so now we can use them in SharePoint app development, and that's great.
Exactly.
The other thing I wanted to point out, just based off the slide, is this concept of this app and SharePoint being separate.
Mm-hmm.
And so for those that are new to the app model, what we're trying to say is there is code and components and assets that you're building as part of a solution that we wrap up in what we call an app, and then that gets deployed to SharePoint.
Yep.
And part of it may live in SharePoint, part of it may live in Azure, part of it may just live in JavaScript in the HTML and that sort of thing.
Exactly. So, Yeah. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that the client-side object model is not limited to just doing app development. In fact, the demo that I'm going to be doing here in a few minutes, what we're going to see is I've just created a visual web part. I added on a couple of HTML controls, and all my client-side JavaScript is actually just inside of there. So if you're looking to make forms that are going to be more responsive, even if you're not necessarily doing apps, you can still take advantage of the client-side object model.
Yeah, and so the app I think you're going to show is what we call a SharePoint hosted app, which is when all the components and so forth go into the app and are deployed just to SharePoint. There's no compiled C# behind the scenes.
Correct. Yeah, we're going to build up to that. Yep. Right. Absolutely. Now, coming back to the slide here, the next little part that you're going to notice is we do have our JavaScript CSUM, and that's going to use the service proxy, which will format everything into XML and send that up to the client SVC file. Now, the client SVC file has been there since the SharePoint 2010 days. It has been enhanced now with 2013 to also include REST, that in the past it was through less data SVC, which is still there in 2013 if you wanted to manually connect up to it. But the preferred way now to do that is to keep using the client SVC. That's where everything is. So you want to execute client-side code, that's going to be the service that you're going to connect up to.
Yeah, and in fact, if somebody writes some JavaScript using the JavaScript object model and then has Fiddler running, you can actually watch the calls, you know, go back to client SVC underneath the covers and take a look at, you know, exactly what's passed back and forth.
Exactly. And then, so you'll notice we're going to make the call over in XML. That's going to, of course, update the content database, do whatever it is that we want it to do. And then eventually it will give us back our data in JSON. And the big thing to keep in mind is that this is, again, going to give us back our CSUM objects. So this is not going to give us back the typical kind of REST that you would expect. This is going to be the client-side objects that we're going to be getting with. Again, if you're used to doing server-side development, this is generally the more natural way to do things.
Right.
Okay. So now let's take a look at a little bit of code here. And the first couple of things that you're going to notice is they have things built up with kind of a proper object. You're going to notice in my demo, I kept things a little bit simpler. I just put the functions right into the global namespace, which isn't a best practice. But whenever I'm going in and taking a look at code, especially for the first time, it's all about just keeping it simple. So let's just strip away anything else. We'll just declare our functions and go from there. So that's what I'm going to have in my demo. But what I want to highlight on our code here, first up is this SP context, and that's the SP client context. The SP is the namespace that's going to contain all of the objects that we're going to be using for CSUM development. Get current at the very end there is going to give us our current environment. And what's nice about getCurrent is that I don't need to pass in a URL or anything like that. I'm basically just simply saying, hey, wherever this code is running, just hook me up to there.
Right. It gives you the context of the web that you're in. Yep. It knows what site it's talking to. You don't do any heavy lifting to get that.
Exactly. The next little line there is where we're going to call off to our site. Now, I've mentioned this 14 times, and I'll probably mention it 14 more times. I tend to be a little redundant at times, say the same thing over and over again, you know, repeat myself, things like, look, I'm just going to keep going until somebody in this room laughs. Thank you. But in any event, we keep saying that this is very similar to the server-side object model. And the thing about the server-side object model is that this is built for .NET. And the biggest thing that we have in .NET that we don't have in JavaScript is a true concept of properties. So in .NET, if I was using the client-side object model, it would actually be basically the same code, that it would simply be context dot and then site, and that would get me my current site. I don't have a property here. So you're going to notice instead that it's going to be get site. So whenever you're working with your different properties, what it's going to be instead of just simply calling the property or setting it to a new value, you're going to be manually calling the get and the set method. So I want to go get the site collection in this case. Then what we're going to do is we're going to call our context.getSite.
So that's got, we've got the client context, then we can go and grab the site object, correct? That's the get underscore site call that you made there.
Exactly. And I'm just noticing there was a little typo on the slide there. So thank you for distracting while I went in and fixed that. Okay. The other thing that you're then going to notice is the casing here. In .NET, convention is to use Pascal casing, meaning that you're going to start with a capital letter. Convention in JavaScript is that you use camel casing. And this is not collaborative application markup language. This is actually C-A-M-E-L, where what you do is you start with a lowercase letter, which you see right there with my E on execute query, and then you'll notice a capital Q and a capital A for our query async. So each word, they're all just shoved together, but each word starts with a capital letter. One of the big things that the JavaScript implementation of the CSOM is trying to do is stick with that convention. So since JavaScript does our camel casing, we're going to stick with camel casing. So you'll notice it'll be lowercase s for site. The next big component up here is my load. So we talked a couple of minutes ago about the fact that we want to limit our round-trip calls. So just because we touch an object does not actually instruct JavaScript or the client-side object model to make the round trip to the server at that point. Because it's possible that maybe what I need to do is I need to go from the site down to a list, down to a folder, down to a particular item. And it's just going to be easier for me to connect to that site, connect to that list, connect to that folder, and then let's go grab the item. But that doesn't necessarily mean that I actually want to go load the site, the list, the folder, and all the data inside of there. So the JavaScript, and actually the client-side object model, regardless of where you're running it from, is not going to load data until we explicitly tell it to load data. And that's where our load method comes into play, where what I'm going to do is I'm going to explicitly tell the client-side object model, okay, this is data that I want, go get this data. However, if we kick back to the code here, this is not an instantaneous call. What this is really actually saying is, hey, by the way, the next time that you round trip back to the server, could you do me a favor? Could you go ahead and grab that data? So it's basically like, hey, you know what? You ask your spouse, a friend, or otherwise, you know, next time that you're out at the store, can you go ahead and grab me this? It's the exact same concept.
Yeah, so it's like, in this case, we're saying, please go and grab me the site object. Like, as if you're going to the corner store, I might say to you, please go get me some milk. Yep. You haven't actually gone and got the milk yet, right?
Exactly. Exactly. The next line thereafter, that execute query async, this is where it's actually going to make the call. This is where it's now going to actually round trip. And so the nice part is that I can do an awful lot of operations here. So I could actually create a list. I could create an item. I could query some data. I could create a site, do whatever it is that I want, call load, do all of that work. And then finally, once we're ready to go, then we go ahead and say execute query async. So it's not until we actually make that call does it actually make the round trip into the server.
Yeah, so the nice bit here is that in this example, we're only showing you loading just the site, mm-hmm. correct? But you could do multiple calls. You could say, I want more information about the site, maybe the lists and that sort of thing, and only do the execute query async once, and it would go and do all of those calls all at once and get all of that data back. Yep. So that's what I was talking about with batching. So telling it what you want, one or many things, and mm-hmm. then finally saying, okay, we're good to go. Go and retrieve the data in one round trip from the server.
Exactly, exactly. Now, what you're going to notice on execute query async, sort of like the name implies, it's not just a clever name, this is going to make that call asynchronously. So it's going to ostensibly spin off a different thread, go off, do its work, and then finally, once it gets the call back from the server, then it's going to make the appropriate method call on the client. And so you'll notice that the two calls that we are, the two functions that we have there are our on success and our on failure. And the two parameters that our execute query async is going to take is, hey, what method do you want us to call on success? What method do you want us to call on failure? And so we'll go ahead and call the appropriate method based on whether or not it succeeds or fails.
Right, right. And so if you're familiar with async calls in C sharp mm-hmm. or what have you, this is very similar.
Exactly, exactly. Now, In order for us to actually go get our data, again, we've already highlighted execute query async, not a whole lot else for me to mention there. But you'll notice up top that we've got our load and our load query. One of the things that Chris mentioned earlier is whenever you're making a call into a remote server and you're getting data back, you want to not only batch, but you want to ask for only what you need. So if I only need certain properties, if I only need certain methods, if I want to actually build up a normal like link query where I'm saying, well, this is the data that I want, you'll notice that we can specify just the data that we want by utilizing that load query.
Yeah, that's really important, right? Because if you've got a document library or a list with, say, 20 columns in it,
yep,
and there's a lot of data in there, and you just want to specify, A, you want to specify what rows you want to bring back,
yep,
and then B, what columns also come back with that data. So if you're only going to use three columns, only ask for three columns.
Exactly. Yeah, I always I mentioned database examples before. Whenever you're querying a database, basically rules number 1 through 10 are all different ways of saying when you build your select statement, only ask for what you need. Same exact concept here. Only ask for what you need.
This is really important for client-side development, right? Because yeah, every call back to the server is going to cost you time and latency and so forth.
Yep.
You want to keep the UI nice and hot and spinning and not waiting for those calls to come back. Also, for things like if you're calling from other systems, like maybe from a phone application or some other system on a high latency connection, this is even bigger of a concern.
Exactly. Now, when it comes to the different things that we're able to do, basically, you name it, we can do it. So if you want to create a brand new site, we can do that. If you want to delete a list, you can do that. And you'll notice that if you want to go in and work with data, you can absolutely do that. So if you want to create a brand new item, if you want to update an item, if you want to delete an item, you can absolutely go in and make all that happen. And in fact, what do you say we take a look at how we're going to make that happen? All right. So back over here, let me get out of my slides. Bouncing my head back and forth is going to be my little stall tactic. Let me open that up. And OK, I'm ready to go. So what I did here while we were at lunch is I added in a little web part right over here. Now, the reason that I did a web part here is because I really wanted to get away for the moment anyway of doing apps. That we're going to have plenty of time on apps, but for right now, I just want to focus in on, let's just do the code. So, got just a basic web part that's been added in. Now, if I open up the ASCX file, there's a couple of different parts here. You know what? I'm going to take advantage. It's the little things in life that make me happy. I love the little right-click close all but this.
Handy. Very handy. And
yes,
full screen. I love it.
Yeah, exactly. Yep. Alt-Shift-Enter, by the way, shortcut key if you're...
Excellent.
Yep. At all interested. Okay. And in fact, let me actually even update my text here on the fly. So what you're going to notice right here is I have a very basic block of HTML. I mean, this is really, I don't even know that I would call this HTML 101. This is HTML 001. we've got two little input boxes, we've got a break, and then we've got a button that's set to be type button. Now, I just want to highlight that real quick here because it's just a normal button. So this is not going to round trip to the server. It's not going to cause a post back or anything like that. It's going to execute my JavaScript instead. You're also going to notice that I've got a dev output right there, or a div output right there, that I'll be putting my very basic little message into. And then right here, I've got the calls to all of my script libraries. Now, I've basically just thrown everything at it, mostly just so I can highlight everything that we've got going on here. I do have the calls into the content delivery networks for Ajax and for jQuery. One of the things that we're going to see when we get into doing our apps a bit later is that I really don't need to have any of this because the apps will pre-bake a lot of that in for me.
Yeah, everybody needs jQuery, right?
Like, yep.
That's pretty much a standard JavaScript library these days.
Exactly. And then you'll also notice that we've got our SPJS file. And that SPJS file, that is the JavaScript file that's going to have the namespace that we're going to use to actually do all of our JavaScript work.
Against SharePoint, right?
Against SharePoint libraries. All right. Now, if we scroll on down and let's focus in on the script here. Up at the very top, we've got a little bit of jQuery here. For those of you that are not familiar with jQuery, what that little dollar paren is doing for us is it's telling the browser to wait until the page is loaded before it executes that. So that way I know that all the different libraries have been loaded, I know that all of the different controls on the form are loaded, I know that everything is all set and ready to go before it's going to execute that little block. What you're also going to notice is I'm going to declare a global variable here called context, and this is going to be my client context. And just like we had on the slide there, you're going to notice that we're going to call getCurrent, and that will, sort of like the name implies, get the current context, so based on what it is that we're connected to. Again, down below, I've got a little bit of jQuery magic here that what I'm going to do is use a selector here. And for those of you that are familiar with CSS, you're very familiar with that little pound sign. That pound means ID or hash sign, whichever you want to call it.
Yep.
The little hash or the little pound sign, that's used to preface an ID. So up top, I had my submit button. So inside of here, I'm just simply calling out that submit button, and I'm wiring up a click event handler. So that way, I'm just not saying inside the button on click equals. I'm just doing that inside my JavaScript. Generally speaking, this is a better way to do it rather than updating the control itself, because this gives me much more centralized configuration of all my controls. So rather than having to run around into the HTML and tell it, okay, well now I want you to do this or now I want you to do that, I can do this right inside the JavaScript. On top of that, if I later decide, well, there's multiple buttons that I want calling this exact same JavaScript, I only have to register just that one time. That the beauty of jQuery is the CSS selectors. So I can grab things based on type, I can grab things based on class, I can do all sorts of different hierarchical things. So I'm looking for all items of a particular type inside of a type with this ID or, you know, whatever it is that, that you want. You get all just sorts of crazy with all that. Okay. So now we actually get into the actual CSOC. And so what you're going to notice is that I'm going to make a call into my movies list. Now, you're going to notice that I'm going to need to step down into this. So I go from our current context to the web. Remember, that's the site.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go get all of our lists. And in particular, I want the movies list. So I'm going to say get by title, movies. That's item one. Step two is I want to create a brand new movie. So that's the eventual goal here. So I'm creating a custom form. You're going to fill everything out. You're going to hit submit. Boom, we'll go in and create a brand new movie. Well, in order to do that, I need a list item creation info object to pass into my add item method on my list. So you'll notice that I'm going to say var movies. I'm going to declare my list creation info. And then I'm going to say movies add item. This right here is what actually gives me the item back. Now, we don't have properties. We don't have a default collection. That normally what I would be able to do at this point inside of the JavaScript inside the server-side object model is I'd be able to just simply say movie and then whatever the name is, so let's say title, and set that equal to whatever I wanted the new value to be. I don't have that inside of here. So that's where my set item comes into play. That what set item will do is it will, well, set the value. And so the two parameters that it's going to be looking for is it's going to be looking for the name of the column, and this is going to be the internal name. So you'll notice title and you'll notice movie description without the space. And then you're also going to notice that I'm going to go grab my values here. Let me just change color since I've got a lot of drawing on the screen here.
Nice bit of jQuery there to pick out the value from the form field, right?
Exactly.
Yeah,
that makes life a lot easier rather than having to go off and grab that I'm using jQuery here. So my two text boxes were movie-title, movie-description, and I'm just grabbing the val, which will get me the information that was inside that text box.
So you've grabbed the list item creation info object, gets you back a model for for this object, then you're going to go set all the parameters on it.
Yep.
Sorry, set the fields on it, or the columns, right?
The columns, fields, yep.
Via way of the set item method, and then you're going to go and send that to SharePoint.
Exactly, yep. Now, one of the other things that you'll notice here is the movie.update. And again, for those of you done server-side object model, this is very familiar to you, that any time that you go in, tweak an object, work with an object, or otherwise, you always have to call update to allow those changes to be saved back. And that's no different inside of here. So I have to call update, and then I'm going to go ahead and load it, basically telling, hey, I now want to work with this. And I'm now going to execute my query async. And this will actually execute the round trip. So that will actually tell it, hey, it's now time to go to the server.
Gotcha.
Cool. And then down here at the very bottom, I've got a very enhanced display here. That's pretty impressive, I know.
This is the jQuery equivalent of printf debugging, right?
Yeah, exactly. That all I'm going to do is I'm just simply going to print out, hey, we created the movie, or hey, something went wrong. So very complex there. All right, so let me get out of full screen and let me deploy this out. So communicating with SharePoint, build started, retracting, adding, activating, form of, no. and so now, well, that's terrible. Okay. So we'll come back over to here, and what you're going to notice is that I've already got my web part added in. You know what? Let's actually get rid of that. Let's kind of do this the proper way. Loading, loading, loading. And let's go ahead and delete and hit OK. There we go. And insert and web part. Now, when I put this together, I honestly just left everything with the defaults, that my main focus was on the code and not so much on making this look pretty. And this goes back to something that we were mentioning before about our web parts, is that if you don't go in and update that web part file, that elements.xml file, what you're going to notice here is that it just puts it inside that custom folder, and you're also going to notice just the terrible name of the web part there, that it's just simply the name of the project dash the name of the web part, and then my visual web part.
Defaults for the win.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. All right. Okay, so loading, loading, loading. Cool. So now, let me go ahead and save that. And let's go ahead and add in our title, and let's say Ghostbusters. And I've been slimed. There we go. Add movie. Sure enough, created movie. And if I go into my movies list, voila, there is our nifty little movie.
There we go. How cool is that?
Yeah.
This is nice because, you know, again, back to those web developers, they're used to using these nice frameworks for JavaScript and so forth.
Yep.
You can take those components, you can add that JavaScript in, you can pack it up in a web part if you want. And drop it on your page, and hey presto, you're good to go.
Yep, that's exactly it.
Nice.
That's exactly it. Cool. So then from there, do you want to drive slides for the rest side of things?
Sure. Let me just fire up the slide here.
Okay.
And
I'll cause a distraction over here. Tance. There's been a couple of people in the chat that have mentioned this. You know, if we get a nice big plate of spaghetti right here, that'd be great.
That doesn't sound like a great idea. Okay. All right. So how about we switch gears a little bit? Let's talk about calling REST services or the REST API in SharePoint.
Yep.
So you've covered talking about or working with SharePoint through the JavaScript client-side object model.
Yep.
Some people call it the JSCSOM. Some people call it the JSOM.
I've heard JSOM quite a bit.
JavaScript object model. Let's switch gears a little bit and talk about using REST with SharePoint instead. And so the difference here is that rather than having these pre-baked JavaScript objects through the use of the CSOM, we're going to be calling and looking at just calling SharePoint direct over HTTP, just using URLs, getting JSON or XML back.
Yep.
So we'll talk a little bit about the API URLs that you use to call into SharePoint. We'll talk about how you can read data, and then how you can update it. And I'll also show you some examples of requesting it back in XML format or in JSON format, and we'll jump into a demo and show you some of that.
Perfect.
So first, hands up everybody who doesn't know what REST is. Well, there's a couple here in the room. maybe a few more out there on the webcast, I'm not sure. Okay, so RESTful services, as you mentioned, representational state transfer.
Yep, I love that name. It just clears everything right up.
You can actually, you know, Bing for that and read all about the principles of REST and what it actually means by the guys that came up with it. But in a nutshell, it's a way that you can, via a URI, address objects in a system.
Yep.
And then get data back in a very, what we call, RESTful way. And so SharePoint provided this in SharePoint 2010
yep.
with just list data.
Right.
And it was a little more limited. So now in 2013, we have a much richer set of REST APIs that we can call, not just to get back list data, but to get back information about the web or the site and those sorts of things. As well. So the surface area has greatly expanded.
Yep.
Like I said, it's all done over HTTP. So you use regular HTTP verbs like get, post, put, delete, merge, that sort of thing. And it's done just over HTTP like you would request a web page. Now, the good thing about this is that you don't need to have the JavaScript CSOM loaded. You don't need to be in .NET managed code. You could be on any system you want and call those URLs. So long as you understand HTTP and either XML or JSON, you should be pretty much good to go. Now, the other thing that SharePoint does is it builds on REST using OData. So for those of you who aren't familiar with OData, it basically adds some querying semantics on top of REST. And lets you do some better sort of querying across the top of these data services. If you want more information about that, you can go to odata.org. It's a standardized protocol.
Yep.
Started by Microsoft some time ago, but now it's with a standards body. And so everybody can go read up about those. But in a nutshell, the code sample you can see down here on the slide, it's very straightforward. You have your site address, so in this case, intranet.contoso.com. And then the API entry point for pretty much everything in the REST services in SharePoint is at the underscore API URL. Now, that is really just hiding the client service behind the scenes. It just makes it look a little nicer, and it's designed eventually maybe we'll only have underscore API to get access. But that's your entry point for all of the REST services.
That just to mention here real quick, that what Chris was highlighting there is that underscore API, it's just simply abstracting away that client SVC, that if you still wanted to make the call directly into client SVC, or technically even still the less data SVC from 2010, you can still do that. That's really not the preferred way to do that. Use the underscore API. That's what it's there for.
Right. It's designed as being a nice one-stop shop for all of your API needs.
Exactly.
Okay, and so then the JavaScript that you can see here on the slide simply goes and asks for this web object from the API
yep.
and then pulls back that data. And then you can see data.d.title is pulling back a piece of data from the JSON returned payload.
Right.
So very, very straightforward. Something to note here is that there aren't any SharePoint libraries involved at this point. So there's no sp.js that needs to be loaded. We're just doing a regular jQuery with getJSON call to that URL and getting back a JSON payload.
Exactly. So Chris has been mentioning, you know, for all of us who've been doing SharePoint development and sort of weren't allowed to play with the cool kids when it came to things like jQuery and REST and so forth, now we have that capability. Now we can just make those calls directly, just like the typical JavaScript developer would. So again, kind of the compare and contrast of why would you do REST, why would you do CSOM, I think, first of all, if you didn't know either of them, that REST is certainly more natural in JavaScript than CSOM is. But what I would also say is that if you are familiar with JavaScript, and then you're probably already familiar with making REST calls, use REST. And if you're making the move from doing the server-side object model, well, you know, I would still say take a look at REST. But if you're looking for the shallowest learning curve, the easiest way to get in, that's definitely going to be CSOM.
Yeah, and the other point I'd make there is that the CSOM gives you a few extra nice-to-haves that you don't get if you're just calling REST directly. And probably the biggest one there is around batching. So you know how you mentioned being able to make a call and get the site information and maybe some list information and then say go and get the data?
Yep.
That's all taken care of by the CSOM for you, whereas if you're making the REST calls yourself, you're going to have to either use some sort of library that does that for you or hand code it or hand wire it all up yourself.
Right.
Okay, so let's just jump back to the slides here for a moment. So a little bit more on the SharePoint REST API URLs. The sample down in the bottom right of the slide here, you can see builds a little bit on the last example. And so you can still see the _API/web. That's going to get us the information about the web. Then we want to say, in this case, we're going to say, I would like to go and get something about the lists. And so we can do /lists, and that gets us access to all of the list information.
Mm-hmm.
Then we can say, I might be interested in just a particular list. And so in this case, you're seeing get by title. So that's going to go and look at all of the lists in that web and say, I want to look for a list called my list. And so it's the title of the list there. At that point, I could execute that query and just get the information back about that list. But in this example, I want to say /items, and that will go and get me the data from that list. And so you need to do, say, /items to go and grab all of the list items and bring them all back.
Yep.
Then we start adding some querying semantics that are added by these OData operators. And so the first one there that you can see, you've got the little question mark. You've got the question mark, and then you've got, let me grab my pen here. So you've got the little question mark in here, then $select equals ID, title. So what that's saying is don't just go and get all of those columns from the list. Say I had 30 or 40 columns or whatever it happens to be. I just want to return the ID and the title fields from that list. And so again, that's going back to that concept of only requesting the information that you want and no more.
Exactly.
Than you need.
Yep.
Then the next row down, we've got this $order equals title. So this is saying order by title. So we're going to get an alphabetical order. And then the $filter operator lets us basically do a subselect, mm-hmm. like in SQL. Or a select in SQL where you're saying, the where operator, saying where the title begins with A or starts with A. And so again, we're using some OData operators, we're doing the filtering semantics, and we're using the starts with method or operator to do that action.
Yep.
And so that's going to jump in, grab all of our list items from the my list with title that begin with A. It's going to order them by title and only return the ID and title columns. Okay, so really there are two types of queries you can do to REST to the REST endpoints. You can either read data or you can write data. So the first one is about reading. Obviously, most people want to start off by reading some sort of data from the SharePoint site. And as you saw, you know, with the CSOM, relatively straightforward. Same thing sort of goes for REST as well. You want to use the web server relative URL field on the _SP page context info object. So what that object is available on every page.
Mm-hmm.
And when you call web server relative URL, that's going to get you the URL for that site. So you can use that as a base to build up your REST URLs.
So that way you don't have to just hard code everything in.
Right. You don't want to hard code the URL of your site, because then if you go install your web part on a different site, it might have a different URL.
Right.
And you wouldn't want to have to go fix that all up and get it all back in. And then you can simply use the same sort of jQuery functions that you're used to using with pretty much anything out there on the internet. Get JSON or the AJAX call to go grab the data. It gets a little more funky when you want to send something to SharePoint. And when I say it gets a little more funky, A, they're a little harder to craft up these requests. And the reason is there is some additional requirements that you have to consider when you're making those calls. The first is what we call passing a form digest. So the form digest is a piece of information that SharePoint renders onto the page during a page request that has a limited lifespan that you need to use when you packet your request back to SharePoint. And you have to attach this digest this form digest object.
Right. Yeah, what that's going to do is that's going to make sure that somebody didn't just simply steal your HTML, put that into their own browser, tweak it a little bit, and maybe bypass some of the constraints or otherwise that you put on there. Or worse yet, that somebody isn't hosting that and essentially trying to trick somebody into offering up information or running that as somebody else and gaining access to data that they really shouldn't have.
Yeah, replay attacks and those sorts of things,
yeah.
Right? So the way you get your form digest is two ways. SharePoint will render the form digest to a hidden field called __ request digest.
Yep.
And so you can use jQuery to query for that object and grab that token out, and then you put it in your payload. Or you can do another query to __API/context_info, and that will also give you a form digest that you can pass along with your post. Now, it's worth pointing out, you don't need these for read operations. You only need these for updates or deletes or some sort of write back post to SharePoint. So for things like creating new items, you have to do it. If you want to go delete an object or update an object, you have to do it. Now, in your example, you didn't need to do this.
Right.
And for those astute watchers would have noticed that you didn't have to get the form digest and put it into your object. And the reason for that is that the JavaScript object model is doing that for you. And it's packaging up all of that stuff behind the scenes. And so you don't have to do this sort of heavy lifting that you need to do with REST. So that's one of these other things that REST doesn't do, you know, just out of the box for you, whereas the CSOM does.
Right, right.
Now, you use slightly different verbs, and by verbs, they're the HTTP verbs that we're talking about. When you're reading data, you use a GET. When you want to create a new item, you use a POST. There are some other verbs that are also interesting to look at. If you want to update an existing item, you can either use the PATCH, MERGE, or PUT verbs. Now, PUT will totally overwrite the object that you're updating, and you need to pass all of the properties. Whereas a patch is just updating certain things out of that object. So deleting, again, the HTTP verb delete is obviously very self-explanatory.
That's going to create a new item, right?
Kind of, except not.
Oh, okay.
The opposite, right?
Okay, all right.
So that's going to completely wipe an object out. So what I thought we could do is just jump into a little bit of a demo and show some common URLs and things like that.
Let's do it.
So let me jump back to my slides here. Let me flip over here. And
I'll cause a distraction.
Da-da-da-da.
Hey, look over here and over here. And that's
okay.
A lovely shade of blue over there and green behind me.
Okay. All right, I'm all set. Let's flip over to the demo box here.
I'm out of jokes.
You used them all in the first half of the day.
You gotta get out of PowerPoint.
Oh, you have to exit PowerPoint. So just bring back up PowerPoint and hit escape.
Oh, there we go. Oh, no, that's minimized. Sorry.
More distractions.
Sorry.
So it's yellow up there. Here, let me fix my hair.
I think I'm good.
Okay.
Hold on. 1 second, caller.
So
now I've gone totally. There we go.
Okay. Yeah, it always takes a second to come back around again.
How are we looking?
Okay, now we're good.
Okay.
All right.
Much
cool.
Better. Okay, so here
we're really live here.
Yeah.
Yes, we're really cooking here on this show.
There is no pre-baked one in the oven.
No, there isn't.
Okay, so this is a developer site,
yep.
And it's actually hosted in SharePoint Online. So my developer site, if you can check out up in the top here, we've got a Office 365 site. You can tell that by .sharepoint.com in the URL. And my developer site is at WAC Sites, WAC Developer.
Yep.
So that's my dev site. I've also got a movies list. So let's just jump in and take a look at that. I've got The Godfather, Forrest Gump, Lord of the Rings, because I'm from New Zealand. I'm either a Hobbit or from Flight of the Conchords. So I like Lord of the Rings. And so what I want to show you quickly is just getting access to this list data straight through the browser, right? So I can come up here into our URL. And I'm going to zoom in on this once I've typed it. So if you can't make this out straight away, don't worry. I'll come back to it in a second. So
I was really hoping you were going to start singing Jenny.
I suck at singing, so I wouldn't.
Okay, fair enough.
I wouldn't burden the world with that. So here I'm using /API/web/lists. And if I hit go on that, I'm going to get back an odd-looking page. Now, if you use Internet Explorer, by default you'll see a page that comes back that looks like this. And what I really want to do is show you what the source of this page looks like before IE takes it and starts formatting it up. Now, the reason IE thinks it's got a web page that it can format like this is because by default, the return payloads from the REST data services are in ATOM format, which is an XML format. But ATOM is also used for blogs, similar to RSS.
Right.
So when we make this call, IE is trying to render it like a blog and make it look a little bit more readable. So the first thing I want to do is jump off into Internet Options and jump over to the Content tab. And there where it says Feeds and Web Slices, I want to come into Settings and say Turn on Feed Reading View and turn that off. And then when I click OK and OK and I refresh this, and where the request comes back, I don't know why it's still giving me this. There we go. So as you can see, we get a whole bunch of XML and ATOM come back. And sorry, XML in the ATOM format. And so although this is pretty interesting, it's very verbose, right? You can see we've got a lot of data here. If we actually dig down a little bit, you'll find information eventually in here about the lists and libraries and so forth that are in this site. And likewise, if I say lists and then I say movies list and hit return on that, I'm going to get back ATOM information, XML, about this movies list. And so that's the metadata about the movies list. But what if I want the items? So then I'll just simply put items on the end of this URL here. Whoops, items. And that will give me back information about the items. So I'm getting back XML and ATOM, but it's not particularly readable or particularly friendly. So what I'm going to do is switch over to a slightly different tool.
Mm-hmm.
And it's called Postman. And it's, unfortunately, an app for Chrome.
For what?
That other browser
that
nobody
okay.
uses.
Right, right.
So here I've got the same site. I've got, I'm using Chrome here, and I've got Postman, which is an app that I've added to it. And you can get this from the App Store for Chrome. Now, the reason I like it is because it makes it really easy straight within the browser to craft up my URLs.
Mm-hmm.
And again, so if I jump into my movies list, this is the same site. You can see we've got the same movies here. If I jump into Postman, I can start pulling out some of those same queries that I showed you straight through the browser. And if I use Zoom it here and take a look at this query, again, it's the same item, sorry, it's the same URL,
mm-hmm.
_API, whack movies, whack, sorry, whack lists, whack movies, list, whack items. So this is going to get and retrieve all of those items. But I'm adding something else to this request. And so here you can see I'm setting the accept header.
Mm-hmm.
So often I get asked this question, so by default I'm getting the ATOM and the XML back. How do I get JSON back? And the unfortunate thing about the implementation of this in SharePoint is that you can't just use the standard notation on the query string to request JSON.
Right.
You have to add this accept header. And it has to be set to application JSON and then semicolon OData equals verbose.
Okay.
Blatantly obvious, right?
Yes, of course.
Once you've done it once. But other than that, it's not so much.
You just go off and copy and paste it later on.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
So now that we've done that, now if I hit send, it's going to send a request to SharePoint, and it's going to bring back the results in JSON. And so this is, I find it a little more readable. But B, and probably more importantly, JSON is way easier to deal with from JavaScript.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't have to do any funky parsing or anything like that.
Right.
You can just use the out-of-the-box jQuery stuff for, you know, requesting this and then dealing with the objects that come back. Super,
yep.
super simple. So that gets us back all of the list items. But why don't we take a look at some other queries? So here I've got a query that differs slightly, and it says, I want to get back all of the items, and I want to select just the title. So we're using the $select equals title notation on the URL. And again, I'm asking for JSON back. And if I hit send, again, you can see now in the objects, I'm just getting back the title field. So again, being able to ask for just the information that you want is really important. And here we're just getting the title field back. This is great for phones and so forth, and you just stripping down all of it, stripping out as much of the data as you can, and getting just the data that you want. Okay, so that's the title. So now let's take a look at a slightly different one, not to do with lists. Let's take a look at the at a web-related one. And so in this case, we're saying underscore API /web, and then we're saying get available web templates, and we're saying the LCID or the locale ID equals 1033. So that's all the English language templates.
US English, what Mark Manassi calls defaultia.
Right, right. So then when we make this call again, we're getting it in JSON. We can see a return payload. We get a description about the template, the category it's in, the thumbnail preview for it, and some other information. And you can see that we've got the LCID or the locale of 1033. So that's a little more interesting because that's about the web. Let's take another look at some other queries we've got here. We've got select title. Where did I lose it? We jump back. Ah, here we go. So now we've got movie items. Now we're going to add a query for it. So again, I talked about JSON adding some things that like the select modifier. So again, we want to just get the title, but now we also want to do a filter. And we want to say, this is effectively the where clause, right? And it says $filter equals title.
Yep.
Equals, and then in quotes, the Godfather. Right, so here we're saying, I want to filter it and get items where only the title equals the Godfather.
Yep.
And so that's kind of the where operator on this request. So I can hit send, and now you can see we're only getting one list item back, and we've got the title equals Godfather. There are a whole load of OData operators that you can use in your queries and so forth. And so I definitely recommend people go up to odata.org, take a look at the different select options, yep, filter options, expand, order by, those kinds of things, and you can get pretty interesting queries put together. One last thing I'd say about OData on the URLs, you sometimes, for those astute listeners out there, will hit URL limits. So I think, I'm not sure what the RFC says about the max URL length.
And again, it's going to vary a little bit from browser to browser.
Right, but sometimes you might hit those URL query length,
right,
issues with,
yep,
calling the REST services.
So if we can throw the code back up there, if you still have it up on your screen.
Yeah.
One other little thing, if you're anything like me, and I know I am, I have a tendency
to... I saw what you did there.
Thank you. It's true. But I have a tendency to forget this, that whenever the ASP.NET service returns back a JSON object using REST, is it always wraps it up inside of that D object. So that,
yes,
that's where all of your data is. So if you just zoom in on that real quick, if you take a look at the JSON, you can actually see the breakdown there where you see D, then you see the results, and then you see all the information that's inside of there. And one very cool thing about the information that's in there is you'll notice that it's going to be a normal object. So you've got title right there, which is just going to become a normal title property that you can then read just like you would a normal, property actually, inside of JavaScript. But everything's inside of D. So whenever you get the response back, it'll always be whatever you called your variable, dot D, dot, and then you'll go loop through all your results or work from there.
Yeah, I mean, it is JavaScript object notation after,
yes,
all, right? And JavaScript is really well-versed in how to deal with this.
Yep.
For those who are doing .NET development, this is not just for JavaScript developers. So you can still call SharePoint on the REST services,
yep,
get JSON back, and then you use a library like JSON.NET that you can get from NuGet.
Yes.
And it'll parse in these things and give you fully-fledged, hydrated,
yep,
.NET objects.
Yep.
You can also do JSON to C#. I think if you Bing for it, there's a website you can paste your JSON payload in, and it will effectively translate that to C# classes for you. So model classes, so you can do strongly typed objects that come back.
Yep,
it's quite handy. Okay, so let's jump back to slides. Let me flip back over here. One moment, caller. All right, so that's the REST API.
Yeah.
So what else are we going to cover?
Actually, that's it. So what we saw is really two ways that you can make client calls into JavaScript. One way is by using the CSOM. And the nice part about using the CSOM, again, is it is very familiar to those of us who've been doing the SharePoint server-side object model. And when you get into JavaScript, again, you know it's a little bit potentially clunkier again. For those of you making the move from JavaScript, there's a little bit more for you to learn. And that's, again, where REST comes into play. That REST is going to be a bit more natural. When it really gets right down to it, though, on the whole, there isn't necessarily a great difference between using one or the other. It really does come down, in a lot of ways, to a matter of personal preference. The one big thing that I would mention about REST as opposed to CSOM is that with CSOM, I can ball everything up and I can do batching. I don't get batching capabilities, unfortunately,
right,
with REST.
Right.
So that's probably the biggest thing about using CSOM over using REST.
I guess the only other thing I would add is with the CSOM, you've got the managed library,
yep,
for people building their code in managed .NET.
Mm-hmm.
You've got the JavaScript one. There's one for phones as well,
yep,
and Silverlight.
Yep.
So so you've got your bases covered on those different platforms.
And there you have it. So we saw how to connect out from the client side. What do you say we take a break? We'll come on back and we'll do apps.
Sounds good.
All right.